Congressman Andy Ireland. Congressman Michael Bilirakis. The President of the National Association of Tour Persons, Mr. John Reed. Paula, just so you'll know, we've installed a safety net on the overhead. The very distinguished mayor from our city of Tampa, Mayor Bob Martinez. You met him a few minutes ago. He is the son of the Vice President of the United States, Jeb Bush. Final guest sharing the stage with President Reagan today is a member of the Catholic Golden Age, Representative Charles Fortenbaugh.
This great man and his lovely family for making America's agenda in the proper order. Faith, family, freedom, work, and peace. The president and the leader of the free world, President Ronald Reagan.
Thank you all very much. Today, making eligible for federal assistance those parts of your state which suffered so much at the hands of Hurricane Elena. At your disposal, we want those who face the brunt of this storm to have a helping hand to begin rebuilding their homes, their businesses, and their lives. Now, it's great to be back in Florida, and I'm going to dare to say the sunshine. May I say what an honor it is to be here with your fine Senator Paula Hawkins, your Congressman Sam Gibbons. I have thought that because I'm not going anyplace. My friends, in this regard, you and I have a lot in common. We've lived out the great part of our lives. As we look to the past, our hearts are filled with gratitude for all the tax reform, and I hope that I won't replow ground that's already been plowed here today. But today, our administration, as you know, has before the Congress a plan for a dramatic tax reform. It's a reform that would make it easier for those way back in Washington can hear you. My friends, don't you believe that our taxes are too high, too complicated, and utterly unfair? Let me go all be in the right place. The tax code we're saddled with today is the result.
Thank you.
President. We want to thank you for coming here. This generation, as you know, we have made a significant contribution, and we want to continue to do so. Now, these folks have signed a postcard to be sent to Washington. We'd like to present you with a replica of that postcard for your battle on the Hill for this tax reform and to put us in a better position to even make more contributions to our great country. This card says, as a senior citizen, I encourage you to support the President's tax reform plan. The plan is pro-growth, pro-family, and fair. Please pass the tax reform plan this year.
I'm going to get one of these for the people.
Got it right.
Lower. We intend to cut the top tax rate on personal income to 35%, and corporations from 46% will be down to 33%, and on the top capital gains rate all the way down to 17.5%. And our objective is to create a small business renaissance in America and make this the age of the entrepreneur. All these 8 million or so new jobs in the last 33 months that have been created, we all know the great bulk of them have been created by small and independent business. With regard to the family, our plan will produce long overdue relief by increasing the standard deduction and practically doubling the personal exemption from the $1,040 to $2,000. And we think it's about time the government stopped punishing families and started helping them. I'm excited about all the good things that the plan will do for America. And if you're excited too, I'd like to ask you to let the folks back in you state legislatures and know how you feel. In addition to tax reform, there'll be a number of other crucial issues, of course, this fall, and I'll need your help on a lot of those, too. We'll have to fight hard to hold down federal spending. We'll need to promote further economic growth while staving off short-sighted protectionist measures, and we need to pass a farm bill that enables our farmers to recapture their rightful share of the world's market. I appreciate your help in our effort to exempt state and local governments from the Fair Labor Standards Act, saving you $3 billion a year and protecting local decision-making. And believe me, we're with you on that. So on all these vital topics, continue to speak out and never underestimate the good that you, as thoughtful and articulate public servants, can do for our entire nation. And I thank you all, and now you've had enough of the monologue.
Mr. President, let me ask you, of course, we've been at the forefront of speaking out for this deductibility of local, state, and taxes, going away with that, and supporting your program, but there's a lot of feeling, I think, of people wondering how serious is the effort really? I mean, is it really going to be a full push for tax reform this year?
Yes. And as a matter of fact, I'm pleased to be able to say, all joking aside, that of all the things that I've faced since I've been up there, this is the one with the most opportunity for a bipartisan, no Democrat or Republican thing, bipartisan push. Ross Jankowski, chairman of the Ways and Means Committee, is determined that he's going to get this out of the committee and that we're going to have this fall. And it's a push. There are some in the election next year, there are some who think maybe it should wait, but the time is now. There's one big thing, if anyone gives you that argument about, well, why not next year or something, the best argument for that is what happens to business and industry in this country if people can't plan because they don't know what the tax program is going to be a year from now.
Mr. President, I think we're all behind that plan. I certainly am. I know the people in New Mexico are. A couple of years ago, you put your full force behind a balanced budget constitutional amendment and spending limit amendment. You got it passed through the Senate. The discharge petition was at least passed in the House. Do you plan, through the remainder of your term, to go ahead and have another push for that balanced budget constitutional amendment?
Oh, yes. And the thing we have to recognize is, everyone has to realize, there's no way that you can balance the budget in 1 year. The way the deficit, and remember that deficit spending is structurally built in, and we've been having it for 50 years or more. And then in 1974, when the Congress passed what they called the Budget and the Planning Act of all that, since that time, instead of it cleaning things up, it's just made it ridiculous. I've only had one budget since I've been there. The rest of the time, we've been operating on continuing resolutions. And so what we have to do is look down the line. If the program right now, the conference report, wasn't as good, I think, as what we first asked for. It doesn't have as much saving. But even that brings our deficit down. We shouldn't be looking at the number of dollars anymore. Things have changed. Look at the percentage of gross national product. Now, under this plan, our estimates are that next year it will be 4% of the gross national product. The next year it will be 3%, and by 1988 it will be 2%. And that path would lead to where you could say in 1990 we can have a balanced budget. We at the same time then should be working for a constitutional amendment that when you can estimate and see this recovery path that way, say down here, it becomes, that's when the balanced budget comes in. And then, Lord, if we're, any of us have got any sense, we will figure some plan, no matter how modest, of starting to pay installments on the national debt. We've got to have a society that shows that we're reducing that, not continuing to expand it as we are now.
Mr. President.
I want to thank you also for your courageous stand on the life issues that you stood for so courageously the last 4 or 5 years. Do you really see light at the end of the tunnel for the nation's farmers?
If we can get the kind of legislation that what we want, and I know Jack Block, the Secretary, is working for this, the government has been the cause of the farmers' problems. If you only look at that part of agriculture that has never been in government programs or subsidy or limitations or anything else, they're not having any economic problems. So what we want, you can't pull the rug out from under in pulling out a system that the farmers have gotten used to. this government, these government programs over these years. But it is our obligation to try and make things right. So we want legislation that will try to help them in the present crisis, but that phasing in will get down to where they're governed by the free market and out of the marketplace. Without, you know, the other day, here's a great problem. We have made it, the government has made it advantageous for the farmer to overproduce. And if there isn't any other industry that the government says, well, if you have more product, you manufacture more product than you can sell, we'll take care of it. And the other day, I thought I'd fall down when entertaining the Prime Minister of Denmark. He started telling me about their troubles. Little Denmark is producing more than they can eat or more than they can export and sell abroad. Overproduction of food. And I asked him, I said, whatever happened to that fellow Malthus that told us about the Malthusian theory that we were all going to starve to death someday? But we want legislation that will be aimed that the farmer can see ahead and say, down here, this is the way it's going to be X number of years.
Mr. President, state of Michigan is going to be critical in the balanced budget fight. That's the one legislature where we really have a hope of getting something to happen this year. Do you intend to campaign in Michigan, or do you use your influence to try to get the Michigan legislature to issue the call?
I don't know what the schedule calls for now. I know that, you know, there are a lot of people planning the schedule and things we can do. But what it means is you would be make it just one state away from a constitutional convention. And I think you could all well understand that the one thing Congress would rather not do is have a constitutional convention in which all kinds of items could be brought up. And we're hopeful that if Michigan does this, that'll be enough for Congress then to say, well, wait a minute, we'll pass the amendment and submit it so that we can avoid having that kind of convention. But I hope that I can. I'd like to help.
Mr. President, you do so many things that are right, for which we thank you and praise God, but nobody's perfect.
That's not nice.
We appreciate very much your strong stand against communism, and we were hopeful that somehow that situation in Nicaragua would turn around so that those leftists could somehow be turned out of it. What do you think?
Well, as you know, we've had problems with the Congress and our government back. And we're going to continue to try because the Nicaraguan situation, not too many people understand that this isn't trying to overthrow a legitimate government. There was a revolution against Somoza. The revolutionaries were made up of several groups. The Sandinistas were probably the oldest, and they have been a pro-communist organization since long before that revolution. And at one point, the revolutionaries went to the Organization of American States, all the other states here in the hemisphere, and asked that organization to appeal to Somoza to step down and end the killing that was going on. And the organization said, well, what are your revolutionary goals? They gave what we could all support: pluralistic society, free democracy down there, free labor unions, freedom of speech and press, all of the things that we all want. And Somoza stepped down. That ended the revolution. But when the government was formed, all of a sudden, just as it's always happened, it happened over in the Middle East when we interfered there before the Vietnam conflict, in Laos. When you've got the communists in kind of a consensus group, pretty soon they take over. Well, this is what the Sandinistas did, in very short. They got rid of revolutionary leaders from the other parties, some of them exiled, some fled the country, some of them were imprisoned. And the Sandinistas are a totalitarian communist government. And the Contras are growing every day in numbers. They're up around 20,000 now from just a few thousand a few years ago. And many of those are deserters from the Nicaragua military. They are mainly controlled by the former participants in the revolution. And all they want is a restoration of their revolutionary goals. Now, this is what we're, why we're supporting them the way we are. And it's been an uphill fight all the way to
make sure we could give you more support from the state of Washington and the project.
Mr. President, can you give us a little clue as to what you might be hoping to gain with your summit meeting?
Off the record.
Just between us, I'll tell you that looking at that Time interview and looking at our own press, I have decided that our press has concluded that Gorbachev is the hero and I'm the bad guy.
And, what did you expect? Oh, that's not
I told some people yesterday, you know, all of this about how good he looks in his pinstripe suit.
Yeah.
I got a pinstripe suit I've been wearing for 5 years and I haven't mentioned
it. Mr. President, you're coming up to New Hampshire next Wednesday. I've got to ask you a question, having run three of your campaigns up there for you. I want to know one thing. Have you found a loophole in the Constitution so you can run again? I want to go back up and help.
No, I'm afraid that's not going to happen. But I'll tell you this. I once listened to some of the people that talk about a one term or something of that kind. Having been in the job, and not for me now, that wouldn't work, I have to tell you that I think it was a great mistake. If we've got a democracy where the people can choose their representatives, if they've chosen you, and choose them as often as they feel that they want to support you, what in the world makes us think that it was democracy to take that away from the people with regard to a president? The people chose Franklin Delano Roosevelt 4 times, and I don't think there's anything wrong with that, unless if you want to have the kind of a government where everybody in government's got to quit at a certain time. But the, wait a minute, what was I? I can see the guys are on their feet. That means, I'm supposed to get on my feet too. Let me tell you, I think that we've got to understand one thing about Gorbachev. He was raised in that system. He has come up in that system. Yes, he knows that they're economically a basket case. And I'm quite sure he wants to do some things about being able to do better with the people. But I don't think there's any idea that he is untrue to the communist philosophy or principle. So what I would hope is that we can come out with an understanding that, okay, we're not going to like each other's systems, they're not going to like ours, and we're not going to like theirs. But I can convince him, and based on facts that we have that would help prove it, that any of his talk about us being a threat to them, we've got no designs on it. Who would want to live in this country and go to a war? On the other hand, we've got a whole background of history of their leaders all the way back to Lenin declaring that we are the enemy, we must be destroyed. They refer to us as the last bastion of capitalism. They have made it plain, I'm not calling names when I say that they reserve the right to lie. They have claimed that themselves. They say anything that will further international socialism is moral. Well, my hope is that if I can convince him that we're the only two countries in the world that can start a world war, we're the only two that can maintain world peace, and if he can see that in the things that he wants to do there, economically and so forth, that practically they will be better off if they don't have to keep this gigantic military buildup. And if we can convince each other that there's a place for us together in the world, in this same world, and without interfering with each other's systems of government, but where they'll be better off practically in reducing the arms and ending the arms race, which they started and which they're way ahead in still. We haven't caught up, and I don't think we ever would catch up. I think we can maintain enough to be a deterrent to them. But it's expensive to both of us. So if we could get that, and to me, the proof would be not in their words, because they made that plain that their words don't count, but make him understand that we would have to have some visible proof in some deeds. For example, getting out of Afghanistan, being willing to reduce their military strength at the same time that we would comfortably reduce ours. Then we could proceed on individual things, we've got trade agreements and things of that kind, and cultural exchanges and so forth. And I think it's worth a try. I've noticed one thing he's done that no other Russian leader's ever done. We had a guest over for dinner one night. He was this fellow from the United Nations that defected to our country. And he's written a book about Moscow and things there. It's the first time I've ever really read not one of our scholars looking from the outside. Here's a guy from the inside telling you what it was like. And had him over there for dinner. It was very interesting. And he made an observation at that time. It wasn't about Gorbachev, who hadn't come along yet. But he said, there isn't a Russian leader there in the upper gun that knows one thing about what the Russian people are thinking. Right. He said they only see him through the bulletproof windows of their limousines as they're driving by them on the streets on their way out of their country home. And this man is the first one that, as you've seen, he's out there as if he were running for office. He's going into factories, he's talking to the guy in the streets. And it could be that he's trying to build up a kind of a support out there because he knows that maybe some of the things he's going to do are not going to meet the approval of the Politburo. And of course, the Politburo pulls the string, he's no longer head man there. So,
Be strong of heart. Be strong of heart.
Oh, yeah. They still want to capture the world.
Yes. They've never retreated from that position, that world domination. And I think if I can convince him that this is why we are acting the way we act, and it won't be enough to just say, oh, we don't mean that, no words. If they will do some deeds. With one of their earlier leaders, I don't mind telling you that I had an opportunity, one-on-one, to say, by way of their ambassador in America, to say something of this kind to them. And I said, for example, and I named something that was sticking in our throats that had to do with some people still being held in the Soviet Union. And I said, look, I won't detail it any further than this because I promised. I said to him, we won't go out and boast about this. We won't say that you did this at our demand or something, right? But if you did that, then I could afford to do something that would be of interest to you. And I wouldn't say anything about it. To this day, this is the first and most public I've ever talked about. But the people I was talking about are living in America now. And that was when I, after they did it, when I lifted the grain embargo. Never said a word about it. Now, if I can...
You wondered what I stood there.
I wanted to go, but then, you know, they kept dying on me. I've been collecting Russian stories that I find the cheap people of Russia, I can bet, through people like this dissident, are telling among themselves, which shows their cynicism about their own government. The last one that I heard was two Russians walking along, and one of them said to the other, is this now real communism? Is this all of it? Have we finally achieved full communism? And the other one said, yeah, I know, things are going to get a lot worse.
Thank you, sir.
Do it again, I'm not going to. I couldn't see him at all.